Justice Jackson?
So Justice Kagan talked about the problem of the agency potentially taking over what is Congress's business. And I guess I'm worried about the different concern, which is about the court taking over what Congress may have intended for the agency to do in this situation. And so all of my questions, the reason why I didn't really engage in the other part of this is because all of my questions really, for you, stem from that concern. You've phrased the question presented in this case as whether certain items, weapons, parts, and kits, or partially complete and disassembled frames or receivers qualify as firearms within the meaning of the statute. And I guess I'm concerned about this framing because it doesn't seem to account, in my view, for the actual claim that the challengers have made here, which is that the agency has exceeded its statutory authority. And so I'm trying to figure out how we're supposed to address what I think is a distinct question about the scope of the agency's authority vis-a-vis the court to fill out the category of what is a firearm. I mean, are we to conclude that an agency exceeds its statutory authority whenever it fails to choose what we think is the best meaning of a statutory term? Is that how the scope of the agency's authority to promulgate a rule is supposed to be determined? We just compare what the agency believes qualifies as a firearm with what we think qualifies as a firearm, and if the agency has something in its definition that we wouldn't have put there, we say the agency has exceeded its authority. I think those seem not right to me as the way of figuring out the question of exceeding the authority. And I think it can't be assumed that the agency exceeds its authority whenever it interprets a statutory term differently than we would, such that all we have to do as a part of this claim here today is just decide what we think a firearm is. Can you react to that?
Sure. So I think, as in any statutory interpretation case, the task of this court is to determine what Congress intended and what it meant. And we think that we have clearly the best interpretation of the language that Congress used, but the court has said time and again that you don't just look at text, you interpret that text in context.
Right,
and
but can, take I account just, can I take you on a little bit of a let me just drill down a little bit, right? The term we are interpreting, I thought, was a category. Congress has said firearms, right, and frames and receivers, which it defines, the firearms part of it, have to be treated in a certain way. And I think in order to implement this statute, the agency has to look at real-world circumstances and determine what particular items fit into that category. I understood the delegation of this entire thing to an agency to be that task. That's what the agency's supposed to be doing. We look at firearm, we look at the definition of the firearm, says the agency, and we look at things in the world and we say X, Y, Z, those are in that category. My question is, when the challenge is X shouldn't have been in that category, does it exceed the agency's authority if the court thinks, yeah, X shouldn't have been in that category? Just, you know, I mean, the agency still has the authority, I think, and in Loper seemed to recognize that Congress may have given the agency the authority to make certain calls. Right?
So I think in responding to this question, it's really yes. helpful to distinguish between the facial challenge here and some of these as-applied applications of the agency's determination of what fits within the definition.
Okay.
I do think that if the court concluded that Congress, in drafting this statute, had, for example, categorically precluded looking at time in deciding whether something's readily convertible, then the agency would be exceeding its authority because, of course, if Congress has said in the statute, you can't think about time,
right.
then the agency can't choose to do so.
Right.
We are miles away from that kind of situation here because all of the factors the agency listed on their face are consistent with the plain meaning of what it is to readily
convert. So what you would have us do is not come up with our list of what items we think should be in the firearm category. Like, we have to think about exactly each thing. In this facial challenge, I think you're saying we need to do something more like did the agency take into account the relevant factors for making the determination of what goes in this category?
That's right, because you don't have any particular products in front of you to examine in light of whether they would fit the definition or not. The only relevant question in this case is the facial question of, does this regulation conflict with anything in the Gun Control Act? And our answer is no. We think that this follows from the plain text of the Gun Control Act and is consistent with judicial precedent interpreting that plain text. With respect to any follow-on questions about particular products, that could all be assessed as applied in light of their specific facts to make a determination about how the factors might cash out in an individual case. But for the frontline question of the agency's authority here, we think everything in the final rule is consistent with the statute Congress wrote.
Thank you.
Thank you, counsel.